Welcome back, everybody. This is the brand new Samsung Galaxy S20 Ultra. This has been a very highly anticipated phone. I had one that arrived on Friday, and normally I use these for a couple weeks before I do a full review, but I did do a lot of shooting with the cameras on this phone, and I want to give you my first impressions in this video. So the S20 Ultra is intended to be a major upgrade from last year's S10 series with the S10, the S10 Plus, and even the S10 5G. It has the highly anticipated 108 megapixel sensor. It has a new zoom functionality, which is actually a digital zoom that will go up to 100x. So they have actually branded this Space Zoom and they're very proud of it. They actually printed it right here on the lens set. It even records 8K video. So all this sounds pretty amazing and, quite frankly, pretty revolutionary. So what are my first impressions after shooting on this all weekend? Well, gets a little bit complicated. So let's start with the camera specs. It's obviously a big housing that's on here. In fact, it's kind of heavy. It's front heavy, even you notice it when you're actually using the camera. But we do have three lenses on here, as well as a depth vision sensor and then a flash. So we have the ultra wide camera, which has a 12 megapixel sensor underneath the lens. We've got the standard wide angle camera, which is the new 108 megapixel sensor. And we also have a telephoto camera with a 48 megapixel sensor underneath. Now the telephoto camera, because it's such a long optic, this is a design that we've seen in a couple other phones, such as the Huawei P30 Pro. I've talked about it a little bit before in these videos, but it is a folded optic design, which basically means the lens is going to be longer than the camera is thick. So it's actually put in at its side and uses a prism or a mirror to project the image onto the lens. I also want to clarify how high megapixel count sensors work in the context of a smartphone camera. So for instance, on the telephoto lens, this is a 48 megapixel sensor that is under that lens. Now, this does not yield a 48 megapixel image. You end up with a 12 megapixel image in the end, which is not bad, but why is that? Well, what they're doing is they're using a process called pixel binning, where basically pixels work in groups to gather light. And the whole idea is that basically because you're downsampling from a much higher megapixel count, that you're going to get a sharper image in the end that just has better resolution and addresses some of the issues with low light performance. So that is important to know. It's also important to know that with the 108 megapixel sensor, this also yields by default a 12 megapixel image with the same technique that it's using to downsample from. Now, this does have the mode where you can actually enable a full 108 megapixel readout. Another important thing about this sensor that Samsung don't really make a big deal about, but it is a much larger sensor in size. This is a 1 over 1.3 inch sensor, and the result on this you're definitely going to notice in these images. So when you look at a lot of these images where you're using a close focus, you're going to get a lot of nice separation. You can even start to see bokeh in these images. That's because we're dealing with a much bigger sensor. This is not like portrait mode bokeh. This is actually from the lens. And I think it looks really nice. Of course, something like bokeh is going to be very subjective. One person might have different tastes than another, but I love the fact that we can now get this out of a smartphone. So what happens when we enable the 108 megapixel readout? Is it going to give us a much clearer, high resolution image? Well, unfortunately, no, it doesn't. What it does do is it shows you all the little problems that you're going to see with these lenses that aren't really designed for high resolution. So mainly this is going to show itself in areas that should be sharp that really aren't. The other thing is it just shows a lot of artifacting and it just looks like the image has been blown up. This is not the same 108 megapixel readout that you can expect to see on, let's say, a medium format phase one camera. The other thing, as I mentioned, you can't shoot raw with that kind of readout. So you're getting a very small file with a very limited data readout in that file. It's just not going to compete on that level. It's really interesting that they're doing this, but unfortunately at this point, I think it's much more of a gimmick than it is a spec that actually means something useful to us as photographers. So let's talk about Space Zoom. Now, Space Zoom is Samsung's new technology that uses a combination of optics and digital zooming and multiple exposures, so on and so forth, to be able to zoom in on objects that are very far away. This is essentially a really long telephoto lens. Now, everything is usually done like 10x, 30x, 40x, 50x. What does that actually mean? Well, the optical telephoto lens in this camera is about a 100 millimeter equivalent on a full frame. I think it's a 24 degree angle of view. So that alone right there is a huge upgrade from what we had in the S10, the S10 Plus. So I do love that. But I'm really excited about this new technology that allows you just to zoom in at a full 100 times. Now, this is not super new. We saw this in the Huawei P30, which would give you a 50x zoom, which was just absolutely ridiculous. But Huawei didn't really brand it as a feature. It was more like we have a great optical telephoto lens, and if you need the digital zoom, it is there. there in a pinch, no pun intended. But this is Samsung. It's not the first camera to have it, but this is a major smartphone company that is going to probably be able to push this in a new direction. In fact, we have a new name. It's the Space Zoom. So I was really excited about this. So on first glance, the images look like this. Yeah, those are trees like way down the street. It's hard to tell what they are. But I guess if you lived in New York in the 1950s and you were into abstract expressionism, that could be kind of cool, I guess. Guys, this looks absurdly bad. And to compact the issue even further, there are autofocus problems. I was standing there trying to shoot with the Super Zoom and it stabilizes impressively considering how long that is zoomed out. I mean, it's ridiculous. If you move your hand just a little bit, I mean, it can make the difference of several feet in the image. And the fact that it can sort of stabilize it at all is very impressive. But you're also cropping in really small on a 48 megapixel sensor. And it is using technology to upscale that and give you a 12 megapixel readout even at full zoom. But unfortunately, it just looks terrible. Now, in all fairness, me standing on my street shooting a tree that's a ways off, and I was in good light, but I'm hand-holding the camera. I felt like I should give this a better chance in a little more controlled environment using a tripod. So basically what I did is I took this downtown to do a little bit different test with this. Okay, if we assume for a second that my earlier tests were kind of askew because hand-holding at such a long distance is a problem, we're gonna fix that today. We've got a tripod. So this is kind of the strip downtown. Behind me is the Tarrant County Convention Center. Little trivia, I saw Tool play here in like 2000. And at the other end, way down there, it's hard to see right now, is the Tarrant County Courthouse. This is a long stretch. It's probably, I don't know, 8-10 blocks down to the other end. So we're gonna test this 100X Space Zoom. And as soon as this motorcycle goes by, so 100X Space Zoom, we are locked down. We're going to see if the power of computational imaging can get focused in on the clock at the top of this tower. So zooming with the S20 Ultra is fairly conventional. You can pinch to zoom, or you can simply click on one of the little icons designating the native optical lens. And you also get on the left-hand side your little magnification guides here. So I can click on any one of these and I can select starting at 0.5X, 1X, 2X, so on and so forth, all the way up to 100X. So for the little test here, I just simply went through the entire range of magnification increments on these buttons. So we're going to start with the ultra wide angle at 0.5X. It is super sharp, looks incredible. We go to 1X, it looks great. 2X, it looks great. 4X, it looks great. When we get up to 10X, we're starting to lose a little bit of resolution. This could have something to do with the sharpening algorithms in here, but it doesn't handle definition very well in foliage, as you can see on the side. This is, my opinion, a pretty long focal length, and they could have stopped here and bragged about it. But when we go up to 30X, you're going to see that we're definitely starting to lose resolution. Again, if we must have it this long, I would have stopped here, because when you go full in at 100X, it's really wormy and gross. And quite frankly, you can see there's a little bit of a halo around the tower, between the tower texture and the sky. And so this is definitely a result of sharpening from somewhere. This is a long way off. Yeah, space zoom. And just to be fair, I did the same test using the Huawei P30 Pro just to see how it would perform. Now, it stops at 50X. You cannot do 100X. You're definitely digital zooming at that point. But I did notice throughout the range that the Huawei definitely held together better than the Samsung. And at least Huawei weren't crazy enough to name this as a branded feature of their device. But either way, it's definitely a gimmick. Once you get around 10X, it's pretty much as far as you're going to get before you start noticeably losing resolution. But interesting test either way. Yeah, space zoom. Which brings us to some autofocus issues. And I mentioned the autofocus issue where if it loses focus when you're zoomed way out like that, it's really tough for the camera to be able to acquire it again. I've also noticed, and this has been reported on other review sites as well, as there are some major autofocus problems with this phone. Even at close distance, when you're shooting portraits or something of somebody like within a reasonable amount of distance between you and the actual phone, what'll happen is if you touch to focus on something, when I make the image, it's not focused on it at all. So you can see, like, for instance, in this image of these plants here, I focused in on the berries. They're clearly not in focus and it looked like they were. Samsung has said that they're going to deal with this issue in a future firmware update. I believe they probably can. That seems like something that can can be worked out. Now, it may sound like I'm being hard on our friends over at Samsung, but I don't think so. And part of the reason I say that is Samsung is a company that's known for having really good cameras in smartphones. The S10 Plus was incredible. I used that phone a lot last year when I was traveling. I did a lot of street photography with it, did a lot of travel photography with it, and I got consistently really good images. It's a wonderful phone to use as a camera, and I really like the S10 Plus. My only gripes with that phone is that it tended to overexpose everything, and it also tended to over-sharpen in post-processing. And those are two things that can be fixed as you tweak your algorithms out. If you look at where Apple is, you can get much more natural-looking images on something like the iPhone 11. That's the direction I was hoping Samsung would take with this. And this is not to be totally unreasonable, because this is the new flagship phone, and it's also something that they're touting is the phone that's going to change photography. And they're also charging people $1,400 for a phone. So I'm sorry, but when you're going to add features in that just become gimmicks, that's what I'm calling out on this. There's also this silly mode on here called single take, and what you do is you hit the button and then you just kind of follow the directions. It'll tell you to move the camera around, and within a couple seconds, what it does is it clips out a lot of crops and random videos with goofy music on them, and spits all this low-res stuff out into your gallery app, and I guess you could share that on social media. Again, this is a gimmick, because I don't understand why photography, which is supposed to be something that's fun, why anybody would want to just sit there, move the camera around, and take all the fun out of it just to have the camera computationally give you some images. I think that's something that Samsung put into this phone to just show off what you can do with 108 megapixels. You see a lot of stuff on their website, which was for illustrative purposes only, meaning it was clearly not shot with space zoom or this phone. But I digress. They're just trying to show off what you can do with this massive sensor. This phone will also shoot 8K video, which doesn't look that bad, but there are some serious limitations. First of all, it's about an 80 megabit per second readout, so you're not getting a lot of data with this file, which is understandable for a phone. I just don't see who's going to need 8K video for doing sharing on social media, because it's going to downsize everything anyway. There's also a really severe crop when you go from 4K footage to 8K footage. And it's only available at 24 frames a second, which also gets bizarre, because I don't have a problem with that. I tend to shoot things at 24 frames per second. I like the cinematic look that that renders, but you can't shoot 24 frames a second on 4K. So you can only do 30 or 60, which is still usable, but I just don't understand where the inconsistencies are on this phone. In all fairness, the ultra wide angle lens, the regular wide angle lens, even the telephoto lens are all fully capable. And I think the problem with the S20 Ultra is that Samsung has simply decided that they're going to have specs that they can put on paper that sound really impressive, like major megapixel counts and 8K video, stuff that just ends up being kind of a gimmick that most people don't need anyway. And it eclipses the fact that we now have a really good telephoto lens in this phone. In fact, that right there was reason enough to upgrade. I think if they continued to work on the computational imaging side of things, the night mode is generally pretty good on any Samsung camera. But at this point, I think this is so much hype that if you are on a budget or you still have an S10 or an S10 Plus, I think that that's a decent phone to go with, and there's really not enough of an upgrade potential in this phone to make you switch over unless you're just bored and have a lot of money. Of course, there are other reasons to upgrade a phone, and I've only been talking about the cameras and the photography modes and the functionality in terms of imaging in this. It has a lot of good features about it. The screen's really good. It's got a higher refresh rate. I can talk about all that in a separate video if you guys are interested, so let me know in the comments below. Until the next video, I'll see you guys then. Later.